Thank you. Thank you. in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
Thanks to James, who had a visit from the Delaware sound engineer during the week. This is working, but it sounds very strong, so that's too much. What are these microphones sounding like?
Better.
A little bit better than the new balance.
Yes.
A little bit. The advice from the engineer was speak up, speak into the microphone, don't stand back from it. But anyway, welcome you to Mass on this, the fifth Sunday in ordinary time, and we are offering the Mass for all people of the parish this morning. But I'm sure everybody will want to put in their prayers the repose of the soul of Father Stephen Waterchair. I know last week the announcement was that he was not very well. He actually died last weekend, almost as the announcements were being made across the diocese. So he has gone to the Lord. Also, priests of your charity pray for two Britishers who have died recently, Keith Bourne and Pamela and Lisa, who are with us today, and also for Mike Kitts, who also has died after quite a lengthy period of illness. So we pray for Bridget as well. So eternal rest of the Lord, and let the perpetual light shine upon them. May they rest in peace. Amen. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the Blessed Mary and the Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen. Let us pray. Keep your family sacred, Lord, with unfailing care, by relying solely on the merits of heavenly grace. They may be defended always by your protection. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, now ever and ever. Amen.
Since it is a duty which has been laid on me. should be punished if I could not preach it. If I had chosen his work myself, I might have been paid for it, but as I am not, it is a responsibility which has been put into my hands. Do you know what my reward is? It is this, in my preaching, to be able to offer the good news free and not insist on the rights which the gospel gives me. So though I am not a slave of any man, I have made myself the slave of everyone, so as to win as many as I could. For the weak, I made myself weak. I made myself open to all men in order to save some at any cost. And I still do this for the sake of the gospel, to have a share in his blessing. The word of the Lord.
This morning's gospel reminds me of a classic Catholic joke. Why did Peter deny Jesus? Because he healed his mother-in-law. We often see original sin as something ancient, which we have inherited, but has no real impact on our daily life here and now. Whereas nothing could be further from the truth, as we see the effects of original sin everywhere, in illness and in death. Were it not for original sin, the created order would be in perfect harmony. And I'll draw your attention to what I've been writing on the back of the newsletter for week after week about last rites. Last rites does not mean last minute. And the Catechism confirms this. The anointing of the sick, it says, is not a sacrament for those who are only at the point of death. Indeed, as soon as anyone of the faithful begins to be in danger of death from sickness, infirmity, or old age, the fitting time for them to receive this sacrament has certainly already arrived. And indeed, surely we will want sacramental grace at the beginning of our serious illness and during it to strengthen us, and not simply at the end, once we've gone through our suffering. And the sacrament of the sick is a liturgical and a communal celebration, whether that be in the home or here in the church. And again, just note, last rites, plural. They include confession, then the anointing with the Holy Oil, and then the reception of the attic and Holy Communion. And so, surely then, it is best if the person is conscious and able to participate in the sacraments of healing, if that is at all possible. Now, while it is true that holy baptism washes us clean of original sin, we know that our nature remains wounded, and our desires can often be disordered. We tend to choose good things and bad things, but sometimes good things even, in the wrong measure, meaning that the whole of our human history has been sadly a story of conflict and struggle with the powers of evil. And sadly again, they will continue to plague us until the very last day. So what can we do? Well, we have some very powerful spiritual weapons. Prayer and fasting are certainly two. And we will think much more about prayer, fasting, and almsgiving very soon. It's a great deal of tension in the weeks of Lent. And I know we've only just really finished with Christmas, but Easter isn't that far away. Lent is just over the horizon. The good news is for you all, it falls on Valentine's Day. What a wonderful way to celebrate with a day of fasting and abstinence. So no rich meals, no fancy chocolates, no cheap champagne. But you do get the opportunity, of course, to go to the greatest love feast there is, the Eucharist. God has called us out of darkness into his wonderful light. But of course, not everyone wants to be dragged into the light, because when we're dragged into the light, it exposes our intentions and our imperfections. And sometimes those imperfections, etc., they just cloud our judgments, meaning we can be slaves to our passions. But at worst, as the church knows from bitter experience over 2,000 years, it can lead to persecution. And Christians have been persecuted, especially when they speak up for the truth, because we know that truth hurts, and you only have to look at the cross to see Christ's five glorious wounds to know that Jesus understands that truth hurts. Thinking to the book of Jonah, that implies that if death was the end, then suffering has no real meaning. Now, the people listening to the book of Job, in their time, the doctrine of the resurrection was not clearly understood. But for us, since the resurrection of Jesus from the dead and Easter, we have a much better understanding of resurrection being what we're aiming for. And the Gustav funeral rite is so good, it's so clear, telling us that for a Christian, we believe that at the point of death, life is changed and not ended. And when this earthly temple of our body turns to dust, a new and eternal dwelling is made ready for our souls in heaven. And so we look upon the cross actually as an instrument, not of torture, but of love. And it's, we see it's the only way really for us to make sense of our pain and anguish, because we know that the cross is not the end of Jesus' journey. And we see that we actually have to go through the cross, and if we do, we end up in the garden of the resurrection. But I think there's a lot of people maybe who have kind of pigeonholed the resurrection as something that, well, I don't really get it, I don't really understand if it's ever going to happen. But think about us as a person. We're a unity of body and soul. So our redemption will not be complete until we get our bodies back. Yes, they won't be quite like they are now, thank God. They'll be like Christ's glorified body. But to help us, the Vatican a couple of years ago just reminded us about what to do with the body after death. And it did reaffirm that yes, for a Catholic, cremation is acceptable, it's an acceptable option. But it's asking us to remember that the body, the ashes, because the ashes are still the body, should really have a final resting place. We shouldn't really go around sprinkling ashes. They should really be buried. Don't worry if you have sprinkled ashes, because God knows where they are, and on the resurrection you can still find them. But it's about the sign we give to the world that we are waiting. We are waiting the resurrection on the last day. That's what we pray in the Mass after the Our Father, that little prayer. We're waiting the blessed hope of the resurrection at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. So we have to go and tell people about this, this hope, this sure and certain hope that St. Paul talks about in the resurrection. We must therefore, like Paul, go and preach the gospel. And, you know, Bishop Richard has been saying this for quite some time, and he's put it in to be missionary disciples. And that was received the moment we were baptized. It's a responsibility placed on every Christian person. We are called according to our abilities, our talents, our particular condition, to go and announce the gospel to the world. Go make disciples of all the nations, says Jesus. We are called to build up the body of Christ, and we are called to lead a holy life. And yes, for many of us, we included, that is a work in progress. But we must be building up the growth of the church. And the Catholic Church is now at 1.3 billion, so it is going in the right direction. But all of us sharing this mission to bring more people into the peace of God's kingdom. But going to one of the Church Fathers, St. John Chrysostom, he anticipates the excuses that we often offer to avoid this duty. He says there is nothing colder than a Christian who is not concerned about the salvation of others. Do not say, I cannot help others. For if you are truly a Christian, it is impossible not to. And indeed, our own bishop, again in the pastoral plan, says, mission is carried out in different ways. In the home, across the generations of the family, he particularly identifies the role grandparents play in the transmission of the faith. Of course, he brings out the work that is done in our schools, where the school and staff and those who are responsible for the children, they come together to work with families and with the parish so that we may all benefit from the encounter of our faith. In fact, mission is part of the apostolate of charity, the apostolate of love, because it should have a deep impact on our wider community. And as I said, my favourite words of the Mass, because the Mass concludes with one little word that I love. Go. Go. Go, you are sent. Go, you are sent to announce the gospel of the Lord. How do you do this? Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Dear brothers and sisters, the Lord heals the brokenhearted and binds up all their wounds, and so we pray.
For a fruitful implementation of the diocesan pastoral plan, may all people be courageous in their openness to change. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For an end to human trafficking and all forms of modern slavery. May all people respect the innate dignity of each person. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
For married couples and those preparing for the sacrament of holy matrimony, may their sacramental union remind us of Christ's love for his bride, the Church. Lord, in your mercy. For vocations to the priesthood and the diaconate and the religious life, may their ministry and prayers bring us to the Lord's healing touch. Lord, in your mercy. For the sick, the housebound, the bereaved, and all those in need, may they know that this community prays for them, ready to assist in various ways. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
the holy souls and those who have served us, especially Father Altinger. May they hear the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Lord, in your mercy, may Our Lady, Mother of Christians, patron of Worth Abbey, pray with us. Hail Mary,
full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
In a moment of silence, we pray for our own needs and intentions.
Almighty Father, we preach the gospel without insisting on our rights. However, we ask you to hear and answer our prayers through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
O Lord, my God, we want
Grant, we pray, that they may become for us now sacraments of eternal life, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Through him the host of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exalted praise as we acclaim.
Thank you.
the mystery of faith.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Lamb who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter my room, but only say the word for myself.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O Lord, who the world that we meet partakers in one bread and one chalice, grant us, we pray, so to live, to be one in Christ, who is joyfully bear fruit for the salvation of the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Would you be seated for one moment, please? Second, or if I have the time, election day is for the Bexhill SVP. If you're using the card reader, please select the second election option. Technically, it's a third party election, so it's not being available. On Friday, 9th of February, at 11 a.m. to Mary Magdalene Church, we have the Rosary Mass for Carl Pearson. It's how the rest of us hymn the Lord and let the church and the church and the rest in peace. If you will manage to go to Father Stephen Austria's funeral, which is at 10:30 on Saturday the 17th of February in the Valley, please go to the website and fill in their form to say that you are going. And there's a form you've got to do. It's full. Okay, that doesn't surprise me. It will be live streamed, I'm led to believe as well. So if you can't go, perhaps you might have to live stream this. First confession is due this Monday at 4 p.m. in the presbytery. Children should really now have completed the first four chapters of the Iron Book, and they should bring that home with them to the first confession. Apart from Monday at 4 p.m. on the 5th, there's two more opportunities, the 12th and the 19th of February. We're going to be giving out quite a lot of time to those. And then the January ones are quite quiet and it's quite cold. We don't want to be taking the first confessions into March or April. Prioritise this next couple of sessions. Joe, please, thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to thank Father for giving me the opportunity just to speak. Every Sunday morning, I'm just astounded on how good the singing sounds from everyone. So thank you. We, the choir, are grateful that we hear the wonderful singing coming back from the congregation. The choir have already started our preparations for Easter, the biggest celebration of the year, the Holy Thursday, Good Friday and Holy Saturday. And we would like to welcome anyone who would like to join the choir just for Easter. You'll be very welcome. We will have our first practice this Friday in the hall here. And then we're practicing every 2 weeks. So anyone who would like to join the choir for Easter, you're very, very welcome. Do come sing with us. Thank you. 6 o'clock. As ever, I'm indebted to the choir for helping me out there. 6 o'clock, Friday night in the hall. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much to our musicians for leading our liturgy Sunday after Sunday and for the special events, especially Easter, the First Communion, confirmations, all those other great occasions that we need to step on. Please stand. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.